I was always a big horror film fan and science fiction fan when I was a kid growing up, and one of my favorite shows on television was The Outer Limits, and then later came Twilight Zone and Star Trek, and later on when I started learning about makeup and makeup effects and stuff, I had the opportunity to work with Fred Phillips and John Chambers, who were the makeup artists that worked in the original Star Trek and Outer Limits show, and one of my first feature films was Star Trek The Motion Picture, directed by Robert Wise, and I had the opportunity to come in and make Spock ears and do the first Klingons with the different spinal cord that fused into their nose, and that was the first time the Klingons had been done that way. So it was really exciting to be on the lot at Paramount and work with some of these old masters and pretty much learn while doing. And shortly after that, I got together with Roger Corman, who was doing kind of their first Star Wars ripoff called Battle Beyond the Stars. And on that film, we had James Cameron was the art director, and many people that were just starting their careers. It was almost like film school for us. And so I got to create a bunch of aliens for that and supervise the makeup effects and whatnot for the Corman films. And one thing led to another, and I started getting more jobs like that. But when Alien Nation came around, Ken Johnson was a director I had worked with previously on a miniseries called V. We had lizard aliens that were masquerading as humans. And he approached me about recreating the makeups from the Alien Nation feature, but simplifying them for television. And we struck up a great relationship and friendship that still goes on today. And we really kind of thought alike. And I could pretty much scrawl out a design on a sheet of paper just instantly. And he would trust me that I would know what it would take to realize these bizarre ideas and biologies that we were just kind of making up as we went along. But that was part of the fun of it. We got to birth babies and delve into their sexual practices and religious aspects of this other race. And the show was really like in the heat of the night with aliens. You didn't have to be a science fiction fan per se to enjoy Alien Nation, because it was a cop show. But they just happened to have aliens integrated into our society. So we had a lot of fun with the biology and the interaction between the humans and the aliens. And Ken Johnson is just a fabulous guy, and I think I was 31 years old when I got contacted for that job, and it seemed like such a huge undertaking. And he put his trust in me, and I, you know, if you put your trust in me, I'm going to throw in the kitchen sink. And I think we did with that show. We did a lot of work for relatively low budget, and at the time, we had Star Trek The Next Generation was our only competition as far as science fiction programs were concerned. And unfortunately, Fox put us up against Monday Night Football. So that was kind of the death knell from the beginning. We really never had a chance in the ratings to go up against, you know, something that most Americans love to watch. But it was a wonderful experience working with all those people, and it really became like a family. And once we finished our first season, we were all set to go for season two, and we had the go-ahead from the studio. You better start getting your guys together and rebudgeting, because we're going to get back into it and, you know, start putting the numbers together. And about a week later, we got a call from Barry Diller, who ran the studio at the time, and they just cut the cord. You know, he never got the show. He never was a fan of the show. He didn't understand it. So we were pretty much left in the lurch, and, you know, worked on other things. And then about 4 years later, some new people over at Fox decided, you know, what do we have that we can start making movies of? What property do we already own? And so their first made-for-TV movie for Fox television was Alien Nation Dark Horizon. So they basically canceled us so that they could bring us back in a more expanded format. And we did about five of those films over the next couple of years.
Okay, well, this is where the makeup process begins for Alienation. You have to get a guy in the chair here, and we tie him up, tape him to the chair, spin it around about 10 times till he's disoriented. Then we take a cast of his head. Now this is a dummy left over from our Enemy Within episode we just finished. And what's done in here is we use an alginate material to actually take a cast of the person's head that's going to be wearing the makeup. After that's done, we cast a stone version, a gypsum cement version of their head, which I'll show you later. And we sculpture in clay the actual character. The first step is putting a bald cap on the actor to protect his hair so nothing sticks to it. Vaseline his eyebrows. In this case, we had him open his mouth, bite down on a cork, kind of twist his head to one side. He needed a chiropractor later. And then we get ready with the makeup design. And now we're at the stone positive of the actor's head. And we make a silicone mold of this if we're going to make a lot more characters. If it's a principal character in the show, we want to make duplicates of it. And this is out of our silicone mold. And the next step from here is to actually put clay on it and start to sculpt the head. This is a generic head being sculpted on one of our cast members. We found several of them that have good head sizes that fit a variety of people. So we have small, medium, and large, male, female. Sometimes we'll sculpt female heads on a male head so that it'll fit a wider variety of cranial sizes. So once this is all blocked out and balanced and the ears are in the right place, the edges are meticulously blended down and a texture is applied, usually with a variety of rubber stamps made off of various citrus fruits, and we'll push right into the clay and create like a texture that is similar to human skin. This just gives you a quick idea. And a lot of it's hand sculpted, and we'll go on, we'll try to match the texture from the face with the head back here so that once the makeup's all put together, it has a nice blend. Remember, this is one of the characters. It'll be whoever happens to show up on that day. Then this is, after this is completed, the mold makers will make a two-part mold of epoxy cal and gypsum. And then when that's cleaned out and put back together, we inject foam rubber through this hole and pipe in the head. And so all this space that was taken up with clay is now filled with foam rubber. And because of the technique of the molding, it squeezes all the excess out into the very finest edge we can get. And that's later trimmed away and applied to the actor. So that's step two.
Making mold for Alienation for Rick Stratton, and it's a continuous show, and it's a one, two, three, I think it's the third year I've been working on it. From the beginning, they take a mold of the actor, and then we cast it up in the material, in plaster material, and then they sculpt the head on the sculptor. And then we get it, and we have to make a mold which can be used to make foam out of it. And most of the time in this one here, it's only a two-piece mold, but the head still had to fit inside. So when the foam comes out, it'll fit the actor perfect. We're using epoxy face on it because it's a harder surface, because we had to have so many cast out of it. But the epoxy cannot, takes about 24 hours to really cure, so we can work on it, but it's not hard enough to take the mold apart before tomorrow morning, and then we will see it. And it's quite a hard time to get the mold apart because it's very sticky, and the material sticks very much to the mold. So it takes about half a day to make the mold, prepare the mold for the foam department.
Mm-hmm.
vast array of background heads. This is the wave station where the heads come before their seams are burned off and their painting's done. So these have been foamed and cooked in the oven, and they've been demolded, and now they're ready for the seaming department. So all these little lines that are going right down the middle of the head here have to be meticulously burned and stippled and blended over with paint to get rid of it. It's just part of the molding process that we hate to have to deal with, but it's very important to the look of these. They have to be seamless, and that's the first seam to go. Now you can see they all have different names. Most of our guest stars from last year's episode become atmosphere of this year's episode because they've either out of the story or they've died or they were bad people and went to their death. So now they become extras walking around in the background. And with a different spot pattern and a different face, there's really quite a variety. You use the same head on 10 different people and get a totally different look based on the paint job. It's not a perfect science, this foam rubber stuff. We're not guaranteed a perfect head every time. We get air bubbles, the temperature changes, humidity levels change. We're constantly altering the formula. I don't think there's any other show that has to produce this many foam rubber products since Planet of the Apes. As far as we do all this work, we seam them, we paint them, we apply them, and they're in the trash at the end of the day. This is the fabulous seaming department. This is Karen Keener, our lead seamer.
Hi.
And she's doing the arduous task of burning and stippling seams and basing them so they're ready for the paint department. And it's a really tough job, and not anybody can do it. And you really have to be a makeup artist with a fine touch and an eye for detail to be able to make it work. It's harder than it looks. So she's got male base color. She's putting on one that she's already burned and stippled. And this will later have the airbrush spot patterns applied to it. So that we formulate the male and female base color 5 gallons at a time so that all the paint that we make in the shop here will match the paint we're using on set and that the color is consistent all the way through. It's all weighed out on a gram scale and to ensure that the color is constant. It's tricky because if you end up with someone with like a dark face and a light head or vice versa, it just doesn't work. These have all had their base put on and ready for the paint department. We have kind of a weird coating system for these that I don't think anybody but me and Brent Armstrong really know what they are, but each one is a different one. If this is a background buck, it means it was a character buck that wasn't good enough for the principal actor, and so we put it for background. This is a background Terry Firma, who's a character from our last episode, and he now becomes a background. And so they have to really keep tabs on who's who, so by the time I get to the set, I know which head is for whom. And it's a big responsibility to keep these things in order. It's an organizational nightmare. This is the paint department where all the freckles are born. Rob and Kathy Tharp and Matthew. Here's a George, the lead detective alien. And these spots are put on with a vacuum form stencil, and some of the characters are just eyeballed and done by hand, like Matt's doing here. We have to ensure that the freckles don't drift from scene to scene. I don't know if anyone else notices it but me, but it's important. She's using a rubber cement paint. It's basically it's red, brown shading, and then we speckle a flesh color over it so it makes the spots appear to be a little bit under the skin and not just decals painted right on it. And then these are heavily powdered and stored and shipped to the set, and we have to put the KY jelly all over them and hence the melon lube at the end of the makeup process. So that makes them look shiny again. This is our lead painter, Rob Tharp, and we've worked together for 20 years or more. And he paints all the principal's freckles, so if you ever see them off kilter, you'll know it's Rob's fault. So this is the Queen Mother Spitting Tongue Head, TM. And this was designed for quick shots when the Queen Mother shoots her tongue out, which has teeth on the end, and basically shoots it down her victim's throats and sucks their guts out. The guy you saw in the chair earlier, he's been sucked dry already. So it's basically a prosthetic that's painted to look like Tiny Ron in the makeup of the Queen Mother. We actually had to put him in all the rubber pieces and have him open his mouth with a cork and that whole thing, and put him through the agony of a second life cast. And you can see this pipe sticking out of the back. We had an air ram attached to this that had a rigid version of this tongue that would shoot out with the push of a button. So once we had him in attack mode and there was a victim in front of him, it would just shoot out the, oh, it's stuck, the tongue out. I'm sorry, it's not rigged up to show you. You'll have to watch the movie. And then we had another series of these that you could actually roll up and put in your mouth with a cable attached to one end, and then the actor would have a bladder in his throat. So as we pulled this out of his mouth, the bladder would deflate, and in reverse, it looks like it shot down his throat and it bulged his neck out. So there's several attacks with the Queen Mother and her mutant offspring, which we also made a mutant head that does this, that we'll be filming on Monday. So it's just for quick shots. It's not articulated. It's not going to sing and dance. And it's just for quick over-the-shoulder shots to show the attack. And then it's a combination of all these in-camera effects that will do something they thought would have to be CGI. In this case, we did it the old-fashioned way with just some good-looking props. And I think it's supposedly very effective in the film. Well, the Queen Mother is a mutant. She's kind of like a big Charles Lawton, Sydney Greenstreet sort of egg-laying pupil stage monstrosity. I mean, she's not supposed to be pretty. And it was kind of a combination of using a head shape left over from last year's Tiny Ron's giant performance and making applications that overlapped. I started out with Tiny in his head from last year, took a life cast of him, sculpted different ear pieces, a different face, the back scoliosis effect, and it's basically just a way to do it quickly and effectively with no time or money, and making something that looks like kind of like the Elephant Man of Aliens. And then he has the mutant offsprings, which are hatched from eggs, and they are actually involved with a lot of fight sequences, and there's a lot of quick, you know, tongue action going on, and people tug of wars with tongues, you know. It's pretty wild stuff for TV. But we get to figure this stuff out, design it, create it, and film it before the censors are even aware what we're doing. So I think we'd get away with some neat stuff. With the characters in Alien Nation, we were kind of coming off of a feature film that had already established a certain look for these alien Tanktonese characters. And when I was approached by Ken Johnson and Fox Studios to recreate the makeups, we knew that we had to simplify them because they were very complicated in that movie. And I felt that a lot of the identity and looks of the actors were completely lost, and they were very stiff. And we needed to come up with a way that we can do them less expensive and not take as much time to do the characters. So to redesign the characters from scratch, basically we had 4 weeks from start to finish to taking our first life cast of an actor till we started shooting the 2-hour pilot. So we were taking the basic idea of the Alien Nation look, but I fused it with an homage to my heroes, which were Fred Phillips and John Chambers and The Outer Limits and Star Trek, and gave it a more generic look. But I left the face of the actor pretty much open, so you could put a variety of heads on different actors, and you could put Bob Hope in a makeup and it would look like Bob Hope as a Tanktonese character. So I think I really made it a lot more flexible
as far as the looks that you could get with them. Of course, when you create a prosthetic character, you start with a live cast of the actor. We take a mold of his head, we make a mold of that so we can reproduce them. The features of the character are sculpted in clay, and when everyone is happy that that's the look we want, we make a series of molds. The molds are then shot with a foam latex solution and baked in an oven, and it's a very time-consuming process. And for Alien Nation, we had to literally make thousands of heads because you could only use one per day. Once you applied the makeup, the headpiece was basically ruined through the removal process for any future use. So every head used on Alien Nation was a brand new, custom-made, custom-created, and manufactured head. We had 6 or 7 principal actors that had to look the same every day. So for those characters, we took life casts and created custom heads and stencil patterns for their spots so that they would stay the same every day. But we also had a wide variety of guest stars and atmosphere performers that had to wear these makeups. And so I came up with a generic process where we do pretty much small, medium, and large, male, female, and part of my job every morning was to be out down on the set at 2 or 3 in the morning and fit people that maybe just showed up on the day. And I got pretty good at being able to look at their head and say, well, he's a size 3 style, you know, whatever number we attached to it. And I would personally fit every performer that worked on the show. I obviously couldn't apply every makeup myself, but I usually kept my applications to the guest stars and to special effects gags if we had to have a baby born or beyond just the character makeups themselves. I had a staff of about 12 people that worked in the makeup lab at, you know, all day long, and then I had another staff of anywhere from 6 to upwards to 30 makeup artists on set that had to apply these things every day. So I was kind of running back and forth between the makeup lab and the studio. And supervising it all, doing makeups, coming back if I had to do something special that night, and kind of running around quite a bit. But it was quite a organizational nightmare. But we learned how to do it and learned by doing. And sometimes when you have a short time, you come up with creative ideas. I think initially, besides our regular cast that got pretty used to the makeup process, when we'd have guest stars or certain atmosphere that would show up and be fitted for a makeup, they were a little apprehensive at first because, well, you're gluing this to me, and oh, what's that stuff you're putting on me? And it's quite it was a 2.5 hour ordeal to be put into one of these makeups. But once they got in the makeup and were able to check themselves out in the mirror, see how their expressions read through the makeup, how everything they did with their face translated through, they became very comfortable and in some cases almost forgot they were wearing makeup. And our producers would sit down with them at lunch and be sitting right across the table from them. And I always try to make the makeup look good to my eye. If you can be in broad daylight with a makeup like this and you don't see any flaws, then chances are on film it's going to be pretty flawless. Occasionally we'd have an atmosphere person that would show up early that was not told by the agency that they were going to be in this type of makeup, and they'd, well, I'm claustrophobic, and oh, you can't do this, they didn't tell me I was going to go through this, and we had to send a couple of people home, but usually we'd try to talk them through it and explain it, and you're not going to have to shave the hair on my face, it's going to grow back like the underbelly of a yak or something. That was mostly women that were concerned with their looks after the makeup, and once I explained it to them and they got in the makeup, they had a ball because their personality did come through the makeup, and they can, it's almost freeing for an actor to put on a prosthetic makeup like that, because then they're really not themselves anymore. They've totally transformed into this otherworldly being, and it allowed them to do things that they wouldn't normally do as a human actor. And a lot of the actors really got a kick out of that. It heightened their acting experience, and it really was a good tool to help them realize the characters. So basically there were differences between the sexes, the male and the female of the Tankanese characters. We tried to keep the spot patterns more of a feminine, small shapes for the women. And the men had bulkier, more masculine spots. And I think one of the sexy things about the women that we did on the show is the way the spot pattern continued down their spines. We made vacuform stencils of backs and actually cut out the spot pattern so that it would take the curvature of the spine and disappear into their pant line or wherever their pants. It was really almost like their hair. So the women had a nice gentle slope down the center. The men, it kind of went like ram horns around their shoulders in the back. So we had very distinct looks and color schemes for both of them. Women could look quite alluring without hair. And we did a lot of stuff with airbrushing to bring their cheekbones way back into the head and kind of fuse up with the ear curve. And a lot of thought and effort went to on the women. They were definitely more difficult makeup to do. Women have peach fuzz on their face. They tend to have more peach fuzz, which when you put the heavy makeup on will tend to make it kind of show up and look a little fuzzy there, which we didn't want. So we learned techniques as we went along to make them a lot more smoother. Men have much more texture to their face, so it was really a little bit of a quicker job to do the male makeup. They didn't require the eyeshadow or the eyelashes and eyeliner and all those things, the lipstick that the women's makeup. So doing a woman alien makeup was a combination of a prosthetic makeup and then a full-blown beauty makeup right over the top of that. But there were very distinct differences that we kept in mind from day one, and it was my job to oversee it and make sure that everything was right, that you didn't put a male head on a female and vice versa. There were very distinct differences. On Alien Nation, being a television series, often we would have guest stars or bit players that would show up on the day knowing they were going to be in some kind of an alien makeup, but not really knowing how they were going to deal with it. And as they watched themselves in the mirror and saw all the different stages and steps of the makeup, by the time they finally got up out of the chair, they felt like they were an alien. They felt like they were somebody different. And I encouraged them, especially if it was their first time in a makeup like this, to sit in front of the mirror and test the limitations of the makeup and do expressions and talk and see if they needed to exaggerate any of their facial expressions to read through the makeup. And I'd say 99% of them found it a pleasurable experience and just had a blast with it. But occasionally you had people that had a little trouble maybe hearing, because it was a piece that it covered your ears, so we would go in with scissors and cut a little slit just to break the surface contact and allow them to hear a little bit more. But then there were other actors that actually preferred the feeling of being isolated and would not let us cut their ears because they liked the fact that things were muffled and it made them feel even more otherworldly and helped them get in deeper into their character. So it depended on the actors, but it was different for everybody, but it was quite a ordeal for certain characters like Eric Pierpoint, who played George. He was probably in the makeup more than anybody in the whole show. Out of an 8-day schedule, it very possibly he would be working 8 days and would rarely get a break from the makeup. And luckily, we were blessed with an actor that didn't perspire. So the makeup always held up really good on him, and it was more the removal process that would be irritating at times, and plus the hours getting in and out of it.